Welcome back to Modern Education. I'm your host, Benjamin S. Woodford, here in the studio once again with Emily Quiles.
Hello.
We're trying a new station, a little studio upgrade today, but we are super excited to be back on the air for another show with you today. We are here every Friday from 3 to 4 p.m. for your commute home. We are streaming online at kzsu.stanford.edu/live, and we are also on the airwaves, 90.1 FM on your dial. Don't ever change it from that dial. In fact, you should just always keep your radio if you like to on 90.1 KZSU, where we're bringing you the noise you need, the news you need, the music you need, and everything that you need, except for, of course, visual stimulation, which is very important to humans, but it is not something we have the capability of doing on the radio. And as you have maybe noticed, and everyone in the studio laughing at me has noticed, I am in quite a mood today. So stick around and you are in for some kind of treat, maybe a couple laughs. You might even learn a thing or two today. This is Modern Education after all. You can always find us online. You can search us Modern Education on Facebook, Modern Education on KZSU on the Instagrams. I'm on the Twitter, Ben Woodford 1. And of course, you can always tweet us in the studio at KZSU or at KZSU DJ. And we always love a good text or call in as well, 855-723-9010. How you doing today, Emily?
I think that was a very special intro.
Well, this
probably
is
probably one of our best.
This is a very
really
special radio station and a very special show with a very special guest who we will bring on the mic now with no further ado. Today, we've got David Segura in the house with us. He's going to come on and we're talking about an very interesting topic, which I think given the affluence and the access to information and knowledge and books and things like that in this area specifically, this is a very relevant topic that I think a lot of people could benefit from, especially the active readers out there.
And the university students that have so much reading to do.
Like, way more reading than is probably humanly kind to ask of people. And we have compassion for that.
That's why we have David here to talk about.
So, David, come on and mic with us here.
What are we talking about today?
Thank you very much for having us.
Yeah, we're super excited to have you in the studio. So you are here, and we're going to talk about speed reading.
Yes, sir.
It's pretty exciting, right?
I get excited about it.
Yeah, it's a fun topic, and I think for me, the most fun thing about it is like the kind of mysticism around it, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. This idea that it's like this special skill. Is that factual in your mind?
Well, that's certainly how I encountered it. So whenever I first heard about it, it did sound like a super secret special skill that I wanted to learn. And, you know, the more you learn about it, the more that I've had the opportunity to learn about it, you realize that it's not that hard and it's very accessible.
Yeah.
And that's why I got so excited when I had the opportunity to come on and talk about it.
Oh, we're super excited as well. And I think our listeners who take this lesson today or the info they get today and then take it out and use it and practice it will be infinitely grateful for what they've learned. So before we get into the nuts and bolts and kind of what it is, tell me the story about how you were first exposed to this or like what got you interested.
Sure. Thank you. So I discovered speed reading when I was in college. I went to a community college for, you know, whatever reasons. I didn't have the opportunity to attend a four-year college. But I was in community college and I always did good academically, but I always felt like I was very slow in general.
Yeah.
And, you know, I consider myself to be meticulous, but other people would just say I'm slow. And I did agree with that.
It's all in perception.
Correct. So, I could always read books and understand them just fine, but I always took a lot longer time than most people. And so whenever I heard somebody just mention it in passing, I'm like, well, that would be cool if that was possible, which kind of led me to research it a little bit more.
Yeah.
And found out that this concept has been around for a long time. I think as far back as 1940.
Wow. Yeah. So not as long as the printing press.
No.
But quite a long time. Yeah.
Reading has always been around for the greater good. And I mean, for me, I relate to you enormously on the fact of like reading slowly. Like I will read things, sentences over and over and over, and it, like sometimes even like not even be able to comprehend it.
Yes.
But actually after, because you have some lessons that you have online, and I took one of your first lessons, and so you perform a test in the beginning. I was about 2:30. After I took it, I was at 3:50. I was like, how did I just like improve in 15 minutes? I was like, okay, is this the placebo effect? Did I just think I was doing like better? I mean, do you know how much, or would you say there is a level of like placebo where you're like, okay, I can now speed read? Or is it really like where you're manipulating your mind to fully comprehend and take it to the next level?
Or do you have a different take?
Yeah, even.
Yeah, no, I think it's actually a little bit of both, which adds a little bit to the enigma of mm-hmm. speed reading, yeah, like yeah. You were mentioning it first. So I guess I'd like to step back a little bit and just define how I interpret speed reading.
Okay, please.
Because it's a word that has different meanings to different people. So if you go back all the way to Evelyn Wood, who mm-hmm. you know, first started talking about speed reading, mm-hmm. she had some very practical methodology, which is kind of based on those exercises that I put on the website.
Yeah, so, yeah.
But speed reading is not just reading fast, right? Because you can certainly just scan a book, and if you could certainly look at all the words, right, in a very short amount of time. But if you didn't understand it, can you really say you read it? You know, so right. For me, speed reading is reading that's obviously a lot faster. It's just optimized, and we're always talking about reading with comprehension. That's just the bottom line.
And recall, right?
Exactly.
And
exactly.
You mentioned skimming, and you know, I was doing some preparation for this, and there's a distinction there between skimming and scanning, right? Now, skimming is trying to sort of get the gist of something very quickly, or get to the part that is important to you, which you may then end up slowing down for, which mm-hmm. is okay, right? I think there's this perception in a lot of our minds, certainly in my own, that speed reading is this like mechanical force where you're just down the page, like machine,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
And that's kind of how we see it portrayed in movies, where the person's just flipping the pages as fast as they can and like hands skimming down the page. And we consider like, oh, well, that just seems impossible, especially if you're like you or me, where you have this perception of being a slow reader, which I think is funny for me to say, given that I know you both know what my initial reading speed was even before we started this journey.
30 speeding.
But I still perceive myself as a slow reader. When I'm going really? Through things, I feel like I should be reading it faster. I feel like I'm like dwelling too much on these points or stopping too often. And I think that's like the consolidation part of really trying to fit what we know into what we already knew beforehand, or like our pre-existing knowledge or schema,
mm-hmm.
yeah. right? But this idea of going through mechanically is not like a realistic way to think about what reading is, right? Now, I lost my point for a minute, but it was skimming and scanning, right?
Yes.
So when you're skimming, you're just trying to like get through and find what you're looking or trying to get the gist.
Mm-hmm.
Now, scanning is different. Scanning is actually going through and looking for something very specific. And so I think this is an interesting part about speed reading in general, in that you're looking for something and that helps you find it,
mm-hmm.
right? So the act of speed reading isn't necessarily just going really fast, but it's actually trying to find something in the text, whether you're skimming or scanning.
Yeah, and I'd even like to add that what I consider speed reading is even more beyond just skimming or scanning.
Mm-hmm.
When I've had the opportunity to teach others, I look at it as, you know, actually reading with full comprehension and just doing this a lot faster than normal. So we're not talking about like those magical, super fast speeds that you see sure. on TV sometimes. We're just talking about something realistic, maybe twice or three times normal reading speeds.
Right.
And it's completely possible to still fully comprehend and retain information at just, you know, 200% speed or 300% speed.
Sure. So what's a normal or like an average reading speed? What is your regular person who hasn't been taught this or learned or taken the time to learn this yet? What do they read at?
So So then there's actually been several different studies, different teams have tested this. But the interesting thing is that everybody always kind of agrees that the average reading speed for the normal person is the same rate at which they talk.
Oh, wow.
Because it's, you know, if we think about when we learn how to read, we actually learned how to translate written symbols into sounds, which we then give meaning to in our minds. Mm-hmm. And so it's no surprise that we kind of learn, you know, we first learn to read out loud, and that's basically at the rate at which we speak.
Right.
And then when we eventually learn how to read silently to ourselves, we just out of habit stick to that same speed. But what's very interesting is that in our minds, there is no speed limit. Well, there are certain speed limits at which you can hear words, but you can easily hear words twice as fast, three times as fast if you just kind of condition yourself gradually.
Right.
And you can actually still process amazingly, accurate amounts of information.
Right. Yeah. And I've heard it said something along the lines of most of us speak around 150 words, but we can listen closer to 300 pretty easily.
Oh, very easily.
And
yes.
So, yeah, it's like your processing speed for intaking is actually quicker than we think. And, you know, people who do audiobooks or different ways of bringing in information auditorily have probably experienced this already. You can start speeding up the playback speed. And it still is pretty comprehensible for most people getting up to like double that speed.
Yes.
It's pretty easy. Now, I actually put it at like 3.5 times speed and seem to do okay with that. But that's like a conditioned thing. It
you have to work up your way to
it. It takes time, and it takes like deliberately working that speed higher and higher until you get to that point. And it's not just like with speed reading, I'm sure you have to slowly work up your speed, right?
Yes, correct. Yeah.
So give us if there was a short way that you could help us understand the actual process of learning how to read quicker. Yeah. Where do you start?
So the easiest place to start is with the physical aspect of reading, because that's where we learn how to read. And I'd like to, mention that I just divide it into two main sections, the physical part of reading and the mental part of reading.
Mm.
And if we kind of focus on those independently, you can do a lot of optimization on each side, on the physical side, as you're, inputting words into your brain.
And so this is the visual scanning part?
Yeah, exactly. So picking up words with your eyes, that's the physical part.
Yeah.
And the mental part is giving it meaning and retaining it, right?
Okay.
So
let's break down one by one.
Perfect.
Yeah.
So if we start with the physical part, which is where we all start reading, right? I'll just stick to one, which is the most, where you can get the most gains right away.
Mm-hmm.
And that's with improving the efficiency at which you move your eyes. Because especially when you're reading silently, the average person will just kind of read at the same speed at which they can listen words. And so this, like you mentioned, will always linger between 150, 250, 300 words per minute, right?
Yeah.
So that's the average. So there are certain exercises that you can do to just train your eyes. And there's been software that's been put out for this. There, exercises and books. I've put out lots of free exercises too on, some videos online. And so this is the physical part where you simply train your eyes to move a little bit faster, to move at a rate and so you guide it, right? One of the ways you could do this with software, you could do it with your hand. So you, for a very dedicated small period of time, let's say 1 minute at a time, you just practice these exercises where you're moving your eyes by following a physical movement.
So you're people on the radio can't see what you're doing right now.
I'm talking with my hands here.
No, it's great, but I'm going to describe it for them. So he's giving us the picture of a book being in front of you and taking your finger and running it across the page, right? And I believe they call this a pacer.
Yes.
Right? In the industry.
And isn't this in like your first lesson with the red dot, and you follow the red dot back and forth? And
exactly.
Like zigzags, and you have to keep up with your eyes. And so in the video, you had three trials and each of 1 minute. And I noticed, so for me, the first time, my eyes hurt. I was like, oh my gosh. I had
physical fatigue, right?
Exactly. Yeah. And then after the second time, because you say, okay, now rest your eyes, look again, and then try it the second time. It got easier. And I'm like, okay. follow the red dot. And so, then the third time it came around, it just became easier. I also see how the sense of okay, so you're training your eyes to read across the page quicker.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
So and this is something that you suggested in your video, actually, to do just with your eyes and not be physically moving your head, because that actually would slow you down, right?
Yeah, because yes. We read with our head, isn't that right? Yeah,
that's, exactly.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, that's been very interesting. I realized that too at the very beginning, that we do all this, I guess, unconsciously, right? Mm-hmm. Where we get used to reading at this rate. And so what we do with our head is that we just simply allow our eyes to remain stationary. We move our neck. And so it's
like
movement.
The bobblehead movement.
Exactly.
Like bouncing.
Yeah. If you look at anybody reading, if they're not mm-hmm. thinking about it, they're actually moving their entire
funny,
head.
It's funny because it's true. You don't need to be moving your head, just your eyes.
And people will even be mouthing the words.
Yes.
Or mentally
thinking the sound of the words, which I think is one of the most profound parts for me just starting to try to pick this skill up, which I don't know, it's been a day or something, but I'm already feeling like it's a lot easier and going quicker. And I was already at like 450 words a minute. And I feel like
impressive.
The Guinness World Records or something was like 25,000 words a minute or something
that.
Insane like that.
Oh, wow.
And I'm like, I wonder if I can get there.
So when you get to 25,000, because I remember you mentioning before that there is a limit of like a threshold where you stop comprehending. Is that specific to each person? Or would you say that's kind of like a rule of thumb for most?
Well, this is what some research has kind of laid out. Obviously, there are always those, ends of the spectrum where people have supernatural abilities. But if we're talking about reading by hearing, which is what the habit we all have, right? We hear the words that we're looking at with our eyes. If we're doing that silently inside our minds, we can actually hear and comprehend words up to about 700 words per minute,
mm-hmm.
while actually hearing the words, right? If we hear them individually. And so what happens is once you get past those first 700 words per minute, anything beyond that is going to insinuate that, you know, that person's not really listening to every single word, which is part
right.
of the goal, right? But so it's hard to really define whether it was in a hard 25,000 versus
right.
Off by a little bit. But the big thing that you're doing once you surpass that level of hearing the words is you're really relying on your visualization or your ability to turn these words into mental images and then into mental movies of every sentence or paragraph that you're picking up, which is kind of takes us into that mental part of reading.
Right. And I think an important piece of this is like chunking, right? Yes. When we're a little kid and we just start learning how to read, you know, we're taught how to sound a word out. And what we're doing is we're chunking little bits of the word each time, right? I'm thinking like collaborate, right? We'd go collab-or-ate, and then we put it all together. And what you described kind of in the pre-show or pre-interview is this idea of that same idea of chunking, but now instead of chunking letters into words, which is what we've all been trained to do, sadly, we haven't been trained to start chunking sections of sentences or whole sentences or pieces of paragraphs.
Yes.
Do you have anything else you want to say about that, or did I sum it up well enough? Add in.
Yeah, I definitely wanted to dig in a little bit more into what this chunking or this visualization,
mm-hmm.
because if we think of a word as a single unit, or, well, you could even go lower, right, to each letter that,
sure.
that makes
yeah,
up a
yeah.
word. We can eventually just look at a word pretty quickly in passing and pick it up, right? Like if we drive by a billboard, it says, you know, come to Stanford.
That's how all of us actually read. Once
yeah.
you become a proficient reader, you're not really dwelling on each word. You're taking it as its own little section that you can intake wholly instead of thinking about each letter individually.
Exactly.
So, I don't know if you've... Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off there.
No.
You ever seen those pieces of text where it's like only like the first and last
yeah,
letter
I was just
really
that.
Actually makes sense?
Like,
and you can still tell what it means because we're so used to seeing them in that configuration.
Mm-hmm.
And I think... that's probably where you're going with the sentence chunks. Right?
Exactly. So if you think of a sentence, or if you try to think of a sentence as a single chunk or as a single concept, it's very easy to turn a sentence into a mental movie, right? Because you have a subject, like a thing mm. or a person or something that has some sort of action attached to it. So if you can train your mind to start actually visualizing or making a visual representation of what this would look like. That's kind of the most basic level of chunking that you can do in speed reading. And
right.
So, you know, you start absorbing thoughts and sentences instead of just words.
Mm. And so what it sounds like what you're describing is kind of the bridge from just hearing the words individually and trying to hear them faster, which is, I think, where I'm at. I can hear them very fast and I can think through them very fast, but I can't I haven't practiced yet the skill of turning it into this mental imagery. And I think that is like the next level as far as instead of just trying to speed up your auditory processing of reading. Turning it into a purposely designed visual representation. And I think that in and of itself is quite a skill, right? It doesn't just happen immediately.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, most of us, right, have the ability, we naturally default to visual interpretation, at least most of us, where, you know, even if we read something, we'll hear it and then we'll turn it into meaning. Mm-hmm. Or even if we if we look at something, we don't have to turn that back into sound. We can take visual input with no filter, right? And we can just understand it. I mean, we can just look at a picture and there's that common saying, you know, picture's worth a thousand words.
Right.
Because our minds are naturally inclined to process mental images. So I think we do have that natural ability, but I think we should learn to rely on it a little bit more. And I think that's the part that I think can provide a huge jump in people's confidence. And that's why the exercises that I like to share are very short. Like you mentioned, they're like 1 minute at a time for a total of like, you know, a few minutes, right? Like if you can do this in 5 minutes, it's a lot less intimidating than going into a 3-day seminar. And same thing. So that's on the physical side, some short exercises. And
right.
There are exercises you could do for the mental processing, which is the visualization exercises.
Sure. And I think that's a great way to be thinking about your reading too, is visualizing it, because in my mind, it makes it a lot more sticky, right? The pictures stick in your head a lot better. And even the act of creating a mental picture makes the information more salient to you, right? It matters more.
Like the movie, you're going right back to like, okay, if I were to remember this information, I would think about that movie. And so is that one of the reasons why the comprehension goes up? Because you're able to kind of just visualize this little movie and play it again in your head?
Yes. And so, you know, there's no magic to it, right? Obviously, this all takes a little bit of practice, a little bit of time investment. But yeah, that's the biggest, I think, the biggest return that you get out of investing some time, that it does become a kind of a compound interest kind of situation, because, you know, the faster you can input these words into your mind, the more that you're practicing the art of visualizing, what, you know, translating this information into like thoughts that mean visual, you know, have a visual representation. So not only are you inputting the information faster, you're storing it, organizing it a lot faster, and then you can naturally recall it a lot faster. So the more that you improve on both fronts, the better that your reading experience can get over time.
That's really, really neat. Now, we're sitting down in the studio today with David Seguro. We're sitting talking about speed reading and a little bit about how you do that if you just joined us on the air. We are here at 90.1 KZSU Stanford on Modern Education. And so, David, I want to jump kind of to a different idea for a minute.
Sure.
And it's this idea of reading something like a novel versus reading something that's more like technical, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm curious how you change your approach when you're reading something that has maybe like vocabulary that you're not as familiar with, or, you know, concepts that are not something that you can attach to a picture easily because it's not something you know well. Mm-hmm. How do you deal with that?
Well, and that's why I prefaced at the beginning, right? To me, reading has to be understood. You can't just skip over words you don't understand, because that's not really reading. You just looked at words. Mm-hmm. So to me, if there is material that has new words, new vocabulary, there's no way around it. You have to stop and define what that word means, because you you know, if you don't understand it, you can't visualize it. You can't build upon that foundation.
Yeah.
So, I do always mention that if you're reading technical or dense material or new information, you know, you can't expect to breeze through it because you naturally have to stop and define the words that you don't understand.
Right. And that is, I think, one of the hardest things about reading new information is trying to find a place to put it, both in the vocabulary challenges, but also just the mental images. I mean, if I'm talking about, you know, I'm reading a paper about scanning people's brains and there's regions of their brains that I don't even know where they go or what they mean, all of a sudden now, how do I come up with a picture for that, right? Do you have strategies for how you visualize new things or ways that you try to make sense of things to make them more sticky for you?
Yes, absolutely. And I keep going back to visualization because I believe visualization to kind of be the format of the brain or the brain's preferred format, right? Mm-hmm. At least in my situation. There's this very cool analogy that Elon Musk brought up a few years ago about organizing information like a tree. And I've used that example so many times because I love it. A tree is just, you know, the concept is simple to visualize where you have a central trunk with a few branches, right? And what Elon says is, you know, if you want to learn new information, you have to have the trunk and the branches first before you can start hanging the leaves. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, if you have nowhere to hang them onto, they're just going to fall off. You're gonna forget all this stuff.
Right. You just got a pile of leaves and now you're going to break.
Exactly. And so I've always used that methodology because when you visualize something, if you're going to see some sort of mental representation of it, your mind automatically connects it with like so many other pieces of information, right?
Right.
I like to use the example of if you imagine a polar bear wearing a red tie and blue pants, that's an image that very quickly comes to mind. How much effort would you say you had to put into creating that mental image?
It's like Yogi Bear.
It popped in my head.
Immediately, hey, boo-boo, want to get a picnic basket?
So if you're able to attach, you know, a mental image to that, you realize how you get so many other data points that, you know, are just under there. I didn't mention what color this bear was, but you naturally attach the color, right?
Color, yeah. What color is your bear, Emily?
He's white.
Oh, really?
Well, he's a polar bear,
yeah,
right?
Oh, mine's brown.
Okay.
he's a brown bear. Is this a racial thing? Did we just get...
No, and so that's where, you know, paying attention is obviously, you know, that's always a prerequisite. And so you want to make sure you understand what the word polar means and stuff like that.
Yeah. Sure.
But
it has a red tie and blue pants.
Yes, exactly. And so, like, you know, if I ask you, how did you imagine this particular bear? Do you imagine him, like, you know, sitting down, lying down, or standing up? What would you say?
Standing up.
Well, mine's actually reading a book.
Oh, okay.
Nice twist. So wait, is he standing up reading this book?
Or no, he's sitting. He's got his legs crossed. He's got some glasses on. He's a very, very sophisticated bear, I must say.
And so, you know, that's always just a quick example how when you somehow attach a visual meaning or some sort of visual representation to
right.
it, you get to attach it to that tree of knowledge in your
whole
mind.
Other that wasn't even stated.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay.
I always imagine like our listeners are imagining us as we're telling them things because
how do they
imagine all this happens? We're either just, you know, voices in the ether or they imagine us actually being people talking to them. I don't know. I mean, maybe you could text us at 855-723-9010 and let us know how you think of us while you're listening to our show. And of course, we always love to hear from our listeners.
Yeah, Ben's not wearing a red tie.
I am not wearing a tie at all.
I can confirm.
We go casual on the radio. We don't have to get all fancy and dressed up. But if you want to imagine us, imagine me in a 3-piece suit and Emily could have a nightgown maybe. And we're at a
nightgown. Okay.
I'm meaning like an evening gown. Like we're at a fancy ball. We're at a fancy ball. Yeah, yeah. We are very debonair if you want to imagine us that way. But really, we're just sitting around the radio station having a good time. So, let's talk about memory for a minute, right? Because you keep bringing up this idea of comprehension, you know, and it's one thing, I think, to store something in short-term memory and just have it for a few seconds as you get through a sentence or a chunk of words or text. What about more long-term retention? How do you approach your, you know, high-speed reading when you're trying to remember it more than just in the moment. Do you have any ways that you deal with that?
Yeah, absolutely. So with long-term retention, you obviously have to have the prerequisite that you paid attention to it and you comprehended it, right?
So you start with short-term retention.
Yeah, obviously. Yeah. Okay. I must, you know, preface that. But with long-term memory, I find pen and paper is gold. I mean, I've always heard it from, you know, people I look up to, and I've learned to rely on it. You know, I just always default to writing stuff that I know I want to remember long term, even though I feel confident sometimes. I do find that writing it down, it just adds this 10x level, right, to your retention.
Sure. And that's like, that is like active reading, whether you're doing it fast or slow, right?
Yes.
You take notes, you ask questions, you engage with what's happening, and that makes essentially a bridge to have a longer term and more meaningful memory of your experience.
Yes, exactly, because the whole reason that I got into, or I got interested in speed reading, was for the purpose of learning, not just, you know, entertainment. And so that's why you have to have that comprehension. And if you look at speed reading not just you know, as this cool trick, or it's just something where you can just, you know, fill your head with information, but as a tool to get you to where you want to be. In my case, I wanted to learn more about the tech industry, and I wanted to, you know, just dive deeper into that subject. But obviously, everybody's got different goals in life. Everybody's got different learning goals. Mm-hmm. But I would say, you know, just reading is obviously fundamental. If you can add speed reading as a tool, it's like adding the tool of you know, if you compare it to walking, it's like the ability to run. It's nice to be able to run when you want, mm-hmm. but you don't always have to run everywhere you go.
Yeah, that would be exhausting to be sprinting everywhere you go. And I love this analogy. I love this analogy because, it goes back to this perception that speed reading is this mechanical forcing yourself through the text. And sometimes, even if you're sprinting, there's a reason to slow down and walk for a minute, right? You come up to some rocky terrain, you got to be a little more careful. Otherwise, you're going to roll your ankle and then you're not running for a while. And I think the analogy to that in reading is to slow down on, you know, difficult vocabulary or a concept that you can't easily visualize and pull the speed down until you're at a place where you feel like you're getting it. Because without comprehension, this is all just an exercise, right?
Yes.
You're just kind of looking at a page as quick as you can. And without the comprehension, what are you doing? Nothing, right?
Yes.
And the other part that you brought up, which I want to drive home for the listeners, is having a reason, what you're looking for, right? You talked about you wanted to learn about something new to you, and this became a tool for you. Now, a tool is only as good as the carpenter who's holding it, and the idea of wanting something from the text, I think, reframes and really changes the point of reading. If you're just reading because you have something in your hand, you can get through it, and it's in one ear and out the other, so to speak, because mm-hmm. there's nothing you're trying to extract. But then when you have purpose, and you're really trying to get something that's meaningful to you from the text,
yes.
it changes everything, right?
Absolutely.
So it has to be done with purpose, like yes. most things that you want to comprehend or do.
Yes, yeah. exactly.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Now, how much pre-reading do you do before you actually go in to start skimming or scanning or just quickly reading a text? Do you
yeah.
focus on and think about pre-reading to try to like find what you want from a text?
Yes, and not all the time, right? I mean, at work, you have to read emails and, you know, you just read them, or there's no need to rush through them unless
sure.
you're reading a really long email.
Right.
But,
TLDR, right?
Yes,
too long,
exactly.
Didn't read.
But
see, I know stuff from pop culture, Emily.
Yeah. So if you're reading a book, it really pays off to spend a few minutes just, you know, reading the front, the back, who recommends it, why do you want to read this book?
Mm-hmm.
Especially, you know, there's more books that you could ever, that anybody could ever consume in their life. So they're
I'm trying.
He's not the average human, though. It's hard to, like, set a benchmark to.
Sorry, I cut you off again. Keep going.
No, so you were talking about, you know, how much pre-reading, and sometimes just taking a few minutes to look at the covers, right? The jackets,
mm-hmm.
the table of contents. Why not take a look at, you know, some of the chapters here and there, take a look at the last few pages. And sometimes that can give you a good idea if that's what you're looking for. I mean, unless you're going into a book out of a recommendation of many people, even then you can still, you know, look to see what would you like to get out of this book, because it gives you a focus and a context, like you mentioned, you know, purpose.
Right.
And so I could compare it to watching a movie. You know, I like to watch trailers before watching some movies. Because you don't want to spend 3 hours of your life sometimes.
right.
Yeah.
You know, this brings up an idea out of the education literature about focused practice, deliberate practice. And it's the idea of setting very deliberate time to do very deliberate things. And I'm relating this actually directly to this idea about pre-reading and thinking about what you want from a book. Because if you're setting an intention, oh, this book can teach me about speed reading. It has these sections which are supposed to do these certain things in each chapter or section that I could read. And you're setting yourself an intention. And maybe the first chapter is very intriguing to you and the last chapter is very intriguing. And maybe there's one chapter in between and maybe the rest of them aren't that interesting to you, even just from like reading the first sentence or the first paragraph. And then if you know that you don't really have something you're looking for, maybe that's the part that you skim real quick and just like, you know, oh, maybe something pops out to you that's interesting, but you don't need to go as deep into that section of the text simply because you don't expect there to be something there that you're really wanting at that moment.
But I've always been taught, at least within university setting, that like you cannot skip a section. Because then, well, maybe it'll be on the test and you didn't read that part. I mean, it's kind of a bad form of testing, but that's the point. But typically, yeah, if this is applied to a student context, maybe this can't be applied so much, but if it's in more of like an entertainment, maybe for your leisure, like...
I don't know. I would argue against that a little bit, and here's why.
Okay, let's see.
First of all, and this is not always happening, I'm sorry for all the people who have been students out there. First of all, if you are going to be tested on something, you should have a clear expectation of what it is you'll be tested on. Which is not always the case, and sadly, that's not how most teachers use testing. But the point is, if you're with a good teacher who is setting expectations clearly, you should know what you're going to be responsible for, which would change what you're looking for within a text. But even beyond that, I would argue that if you don't have a desire for it and you don't have something you're trying to get from it, you're going to read it and not remember it anyway. Yeah. So at that point, it's like now you're just going through the act of reading without actually retaining and comprehending, which I think is what you're saying is like the most important part, right? Comprehension.
Yeah. And I'd go back to, you know, thinking about the purpose with which, you know, why you're reading a book. And so if it's because it's required part of this class and the teacher said read it all, then that gives you a reason to, you know, to read it all. So, but yeah,
not a very compelling reason.
Sadly. All for the students out there.
Yeah, but it does help when your average reading speed is already higher than the average person, because you've spent some time, you know, developing your physical input speed, and you've spent time developing your visualization skills. So that, I believe for me, it gave me the confidence very early on to take on any sort of new learning, because I broke it down to these two simple concepts. Okay, I just have to get through it, and I just have to learn how to organize it. And that, I think, made a huge difference, because before I would have been intimidated by many topics, and I think just boosting my confidence in reading a little bit, I think it eventually led to making a huge difference in my life.
Wow. Yeah. And that, I love the part you're bringing up about the confidence, because the more confident you are in your skill, the more audacious goals you're going to take on, you know, the more you're going to push your reading speed ability or your comprehension ability or your ability to retain the information longer term. And that is a process, right? It doesn't just start where you're like, okay, I'm slow, now I'm fast, and that's the process, right? No. It is a progression of intentionally trying to improve that speed and improve that comprehension and retention and all these other things. Yeah. Now, preparing for this interview, there was some ideas that came into my sphere about how to go about practicing this. And some of the stuff that was mentioned in some of the things I was reading was talking about, like, creating opportunities to practice in your everyday life. You know, you pull out a newspaper article, you just maybe set a pace and use your finger to run across the page, or use a metronome to try to set, like, every click is a line or something of that nature, where you're deliberately building up your speed with some supports, right? Mm. Now, beyond that, we can also, you know, we can read books and all these other things, but I think that daily sort of interpretation of how to do this on a regular basis, so it's not a chore. To me, that was profound to think about it that way, because we get, I think a lot of us at least, maybe not Emily, she's pretty much a rock star, but most of us, I think we will, you know, we'll get daunted by even the idea of starting something new like this. Like, what, I got to like relearn how to read? I feel like I'm already good at reading. Why do I have mm-hmm. to do this? And so that for me was helpful to think, okay, when I'm like reading a cereal box, I can scan it more quickly and see what I get from it, right? Or when I'm reading a newspaper real quick, just in passing, or waiting for the doctor's office, I can still work on my speed reading approach and, you know, trying to improve it. Now, how do you go about, you're probably not practicing anymore. How do you go about telling people how to practice or to teach them to begin embedding this into their way of reading?
So I agree with you 100% that habits are 1,000 times more powerful than any like focused effort you do independently, right? So I've tried to develop the habit of just reading every day for a few minutes. Mm. Obviously there are times when
life happens to you too, right?
But I do recommend, you know, creating a habit of reading a little bit every day. That's obviously the first thing. But if you can set a few minutes aside and just habitually practice, there are, you know, a few other, there's two options I'll mention. One of them is just practice moving your eyes. You could do this anywhere. Mm. And you could just, you know, practice moving them left to right, up and down.
Just
and
not in public.
I mean, who cares what people think? We're learning something here.
So yeah, the cool thing is, you know, it requires very little as far as tools, you know, to just move your eyes and measure that, even for a few minutes at a time. The other option is reading with, for example, tools such as Audible, where you can hear an audiobook. And if you have the print version or Kindle version, something where you can actually be looking as you're reading. Mm-hmm. You can actually just have this as a tool to practice. So you can actually start increasing the speed, you know, 1.25, 1.5, and actually following along and just doing that for a set period of time. That, you know, it's kind of guided and it's all done for you. All you have to do is follow
along. Well, that's a pace, right?
Yes, exactly.
So that is setting a pace for you, and it's actually a little bit mechanical, kind of like a metronome, or if you're moving your finger across the page at a steady pace, that it essentially makes a reason to go faster than you would hear it.
Yes.
Which I think is the kind of the breaking the habit stage of learning how to do this, because we have it so deeply ingrained. I know how to read. This is how I read.
Yeah.
And so what you're describing is, like, to me, is a bridge to help you start to hear faster and think a little bit faster on what you're intaking, which is easier than like saying it that fast, right?
Yes.
This is fascinating to me, honestly. Like, I'm wondering, and I think you've even mentioned this, like, why are we taught to read in school and then not taught to take it to the next level, right?
Exactly. Like, why isn't this common knowledge?
Well,
that's what I've been asking. That's what we're working on right now, right?
Yeah, no. So that's why when the opportunity came up to come speak mm-hmm. with you guys about this, I love it. I believe that more people should be aware. Obviously, it's not of interest to everyone out there. Not everyone loves reading, but there are, you know, people who like reading and sometimes just think they're slow readers, which I used to think that myself. So if you can kind of reassure people that this is very accessible, it doesn't take a lot of time, it doesn't take a lot of effort. If you have a human brain and you can read, the potential is very high to start increasing that if you so wish.
So it's a matter of just doing it.
Yeah.
and intentionally doing it too, right? Setting an intention to try some of these tactics and strategies and then try to improve them.
But I think that's like one of the nicest takeaways from this is that it's not this special gift that's given to you at conception. It's just like something that you can improve on and something that you could just take to the next level.
And if I can just throw in a little neuroscience here, the beauty of the way our brains work is that our brain is very plastic, in that they say plastic in that, you know, plastic is malleable. You can change the shape of it. You can put it into a mold. And the way our brain works is that the more we practice a skill, the more we practiced using certain neural pathways in certain ways, they strengthen. This process is called myelination. And what that does is whatever circuits you're using most often create it's like a fatty layer of tissue that goes around that that synapse and the track in between neurons. Okay. And what that myelination does is it increases the speed of communication through that neural circuit. And this is powerful when you think of practice, because practice is the act of making something easier to access and more quickly, and we call it automaticity. It's the ability to build up an automatic reaction in that situation that you don't have to think about anymore. And so the myelination is essentially your brain reinforcing this thing that you're practicing and making it quicker, faster, more efficient. And so this, just like anything else, like learning mathematics or learning to read, all of these skills that we start to learn actually build up and become more and more proficient, more easy to access, more easy to reproduce. And I think this is just like any of those other skills. Our brain will plastically reorganize itself to do this more quickly. Mm-hmm. The longer you've practiced and the more energy and time you've put into refining and honing these skills, like the visualization of words into pictures, mm-hmm. for instance.
And just to an example. So the way I visualized what you were describing is I kept going back to this tree in my mind, and how if you add a new leaf, you know, a set of new leaves to a certain branch, and the more that gets fed, that little branch gets thicker and it starts growing.
Just like a tree actually would grow, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Going back to the tree.
Well, leaves, you know, leaves soak up the sun. And that is the food, one part source of food for the tree. So if you think of your brain as being this tree, the more leaves you're putting on it, the more surface area you have to pull in new energy,
analogy.
Right? It is beautiful. I love trees, too. Yeah. I'm a tree hugger, I think.
I like trees, yeah.
Okay. Now, David, let's be real here.
David.
You are in day one. You just heard this episode, and you are, like, stoked, right? You're thinking, I want to learn to speed read. This sounds pretty cool. Where do you start? Nuts and bolts.
Well, there's lots of resources online. And, you know, just start looking into it a little bit. I also have a website where I've got some free exercises. And mm-hmm. I'm sure you can put up the link later. But just start looking into it. There are different, you know, courses. I'm sure maybe even locally. So if you think of speed reading as, again, you know, the two parts, the physical process of reading and then the mental process. So if you just look for physical exercises, there's tons of free resources online. And so just start looking into it. I think just getting the curiosity stoked for some people is all it takes. And you know, they jump right into it.
Yeah. Yeah. And I love that. That to me, that is the teacher's answer in its full epitome.
Curiosity.
Embrace your curiosity. Yeah, start looking. Start trying. And, you know, things can blossom, right? You can have your little tiny seed turn into a sapling, turn into a tree of knowledge.
Yes.
And that's beautiful, right? I think that's the goal of every teacher, is that someone will take on their own learning. And I love this part about your story and getting exposed to this, because you were curious and you had something you wanted to find. And you turned it into something that now has probably changed, helped shape your life in a lot of ways, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I keep saying that it's like a compound effect, mm-hmm. because, you know, one thing leads to another. The more opportunities come up, the more you learn about certain things, the more that you can then, you know, pick up or understand about different subjects. And I'm a huge fan, and I to this day I consider myself a lifelong learner. I look forward to just learning so much new stuff.
Yeah, and that to me is the real passion of life, is to be able to learn. And
yeah, no, I hope your tree keeps growing.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah,
yes, Ben.
Absolutely. Yeah, and you know, to me, just reading is, I think, one of the most important skills anyone can ever take on in their lives, because the reality is you could not live 1,000 lifetimes on your own. And, you know, maybe reincarnation is real and that's a thing and we all live 1,000 lifetimes. I don't really know. So I can just only say I'm here now and I'm going to have to live with that.
Yeah.
But through reading books, you are able to essentially soak up the knowledge of hundreds or thousands of other people's experience. And to me, that's like the fruit of what reading allows us to do. Mm-hmm. We can take in so much more. We can take on perspectives and experiences and knowledge to a level that we could never have had the experiences ourselves for.
Yeah. Yeah, if you think back to our ancestors before they had reading as a tool, I mean, they had to rely on, like, you know, verbal communication, yeah, passing right. down stories. And I think that's why humanity has been able to advance so much, you know, exponentially recently, because once you have a way to capture, you know, experiences, like you're saying, right. and knowledge, then that can not only start traveling across distances, but across time, you know, and so that's why I believe very strongly in the concept of the shoulders of giants, how, you know, that is what has helped us get through here throughout many generations, because we can carry that knowledge forward.
Right, right. And yeah, I think in the history of humanity, there's been a few major turning points. One of them was agriculture. We were able to have more food than we needed, so we got to escape from starting to look for food. The next, or maybe not the next, but another real big turning point was the printing press, mm-hmm. because it allowed knowledge to be not this exclusive thing that only priests and clergy were able to access in the few handwritten transcribed books, but now books became more accessible to the whole world. Mm-hmm. And then I think, you know, another big one in this sort of grand progression of human history was Industrial Revolution, right? We were able to take things and scale them at a speed much faster than we ever had. And so speed reading, to me, is essentially a bridge to be able to take this invention of books in general and accessible print, and then the explosion of knowledge that, and, you know, I guess the internet revolution would be the one after the Industrial Revolution, right? Mm-hmm. And that has been another explosion akin or maybe even bigger than the printing press, or at least along the same vein, right? And so we're living in this world where there's so much information, it's almost impossible to digest it all.
And speed reading can be that tool to help maybe regain some readers again. Because when you talked about, okay, we're going to be talking about speed reading this week, I was like, oh, interesting. I can start maybe like thinking about reading these deep texts that I just like felt like I could never get to because I'm too slow.
Right.
Thank
right.
you for regaining that like sense of confidence. Maybe hopefully some listeners have also thought the same.
Yeah, that's that was my takeaway too, that all of a sudden I felt not so overwhelmed with the possibility of reading this thick book.
Yeah.
You're just like, well, maybe I can power through it. And like you said, it's about building that confidence.
You know, David, I think that's a great place to leave off for today. This was such a great hour. I can't believe the hour's up already, but it is.
Oh, wow.
Time flies.
I told you.